So great to be back. We'll do the order of service a little differently this evening. Sing a couple songs. Brother Scott will come present the word. Then we will keep going. I'll come back up. We'll take prayer requests. I'll ask three or four men to, we'll stay together here. We'll pray and then stay here again still. And we will partake of the Lord's Supper directly following prayer. And Cole will try to remind people as they come in. Otherwise, while we're doing prayer requests, we'll make sure that everybody has that wants one can have what they need for the Lord's Supper. Turn to 553, come thou fount of every blessing. 553. Let's stand together, we'll sing all three verses. Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. 553. Here I raise mine Ebenezer, hither by thy help I'm come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger. Was his precious blood. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Steve Bordiarto, would you lead us in prayer, please?
Dear God, Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, again for bringing each one of us here today. Thank you for allowing us to resume our midweek service in person. Lord, I pray us for tonight that you prepare each one of our hearts. Dear Brother Scott, as he brings us the message for the evening. Really help us recover from his procedure the other day. Thank you for everything you've done for us.
You may be seated. Turn to 510. 510, near to the heart of God. We'll sing the first and last verses, 510.
There is a place of quiet rest. Near to the heart of God.
Good evening.
Good evening.
What a pleasure it is to be back in the middle of the week.
Amen.
So we're resuming the preaching class. As we began the book of Titus quite a while ago, I think it was 5 months ago when that we had to break off from our progress through the book of Titus. And so I have put a 5 month pause on this sermon, and it's been interesting because I feel like it has changed shape over that time, putting it away for so long and then taking it back up. But why don't we turn to Titus, and we're in chapter 2. I'm going to go ahead and back up and read the entire chapter, because tonight we'll be talking about the final verses of chapter 2. It's a short chapter. Hear the word of God in Titus chapter 2. But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine. And I should preface that what we've just heard about in doctrine, or in Titus, is talking about false teachers. So in contrast, he's saying, but speak thou the things which become sound doctrine. Verse 2. That the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience. The aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. Young men likewise exhort to be sober-minded, in all things showing thyself a pattern of good works, in doctrine showing uncorruptness, gravity, sincerity, sound speech that cannot be condemned, that he that is of the contrary part may be ashamed, having no evil thing to say of you. Exhort servants to be obedient unto their own masters, and to please them well in all things, not answering again, not purloining, but showing all good fidelity, that they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior in all things. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that, denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee. Let us pray. Father God, I thank you for the great privilege of being in this assembly, of gathering together with your saints to worship you and sing your praises, Lord. Lord God, I ask that you would bless me with the ability to simply be a vessel and to read in this book in the law of God distinctly and to give the sense and to cause us to understand the reading. In Jesus' name, amen. So I ask your indulgence right off the bat. I have to use this regularly. And if I stop sweating, call 911. I used to tell that to my choir, so it's an old joke. So, Titus chapter 2. We just heard a whole bunch of instructions to Titus from Paul as to how he should treat the various members of the assembly, right? So we went through this, but it's interesting that the very first statement in this chapter is really kind of one of the cornerstones of the entire book, and that is, but speak thou the things which become sound doctrine. And what we are going to be looking at tonight is verses 11 through 15. The grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared unto all men, teaching us. So if you look closely at that statement, who is teaching us? It's the grace of God. Amen. The grace of God teaches us. It took me a while, actually quite a while, to try and make any sense out of that. The grace of God bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us. Well, how does that happen? I don't understand that. That doesn't make any sense to me. People teach, you know. David Bond teaches Sunday school, and Pastor Brooks teaches us regularly from the pulpit. But how does the grace of God teach us anything? How does an attribute teach us? And as I looked through this and tried to understand it, I'm not a grammaticist, but I did have to go in and dissect the language here a little bit. And the teaching, to teach us, that is an active voice, and that means, like we just talked about, that the subject of this, that the subject is in fact the grace of God. So it is that subject. That's what's teaching us. So that's true. We've got that right. It is the grace of God that is teaching us. And if you think of this kind of in another way, or if you look at other examples in life, it starts to take a little bit more weight to it. It starts to come clear in your thinking. When I see the young children, Genevieve and these three lovelies back here, and we've got a couple others, one over here, and lots of activity around here, and when they get very excited and are really having a great time, they are laughing, and they are just expressing the most amazing amount of joy. And I was thinking to myself, well, when I see that, that teaches me about joy. That teaches me about that incredible innocence, that purity. And I love that. I love that. And so that's how something that's not a person, but it's an attribute, that can teach me something. You know, Roger is our deacon, and his selfless service to this church, that teaches me about the love for God and love for your brethren. It brings to life 1 John 3:14. We know that we have passed from death into life because we love the brethren. It brings it to life. It instructs. It teaches. The hard work of a talented athlete, like an Olympic athlete, right? To see that's instructive. It teaches you about excellence. It teaches you about hard work, the result of that. So I don't know about you, but for me, if I start thinking about that the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us, now I'm starting to get a little bit more of a picture of this. The word teaching has the sense of cause to learn, but it also is the same sense of a father training a child.
Right.
So there is that aspect of trial, of chastening, of maybe a harshness to the learning. It's not just a learning that comes by witnessing that. By witnessing somebody else do something, we can learn. We can glean from that. But it also comes from learning through experience. And that experience can be harsh, can be hard sometimes. Hebrews 12:6, for whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son that he receiveth. The ing ending in teaching, and it holds true in English and in Greek, it makes this a participle. And that is, it has continuing action. It's not something that is static, but it's moving. So this teaching continues and happens and works ongoing in time. And so to me, the first thing that came to my mind was sanctification. So this is not part of salvation, this is what happens afterwards. Right, this is the growth, becoming conformed to the image of Christ. So this is a process, this is an ongoing thing, this being taught, this teaching, experiencing. So the grace of God that bringeth salvation is not somehow a fourth person of the Godhead or something like that, right? This is actually an attribute. This is part of God that is in his word. The grace of God that bringeth salvation is definitely something we find in the Word of God, and let's delve into it now. So then, what does the grace of God that bringeth salvation teach us? What does it cause us to learn? If we look at verse 12, if we go to our passage now, this is chapter 2, verse 12, teaching us that we should be denying. We see that we should be denying. Denying ungodliness and denying worldly lusts. Ungodliness is a lack of reverence or impiety, wickedness, disregard for God. Typically, it's just the attitude that you find in the world. Ungodliness and wickedness, an absolute rejection of God. So we deny that. This is something that happens when you get saved. This is one of the first things that happens, is you deny that wickedness, that ungodliness. Denying worldly lusts, the lusts of the flesh, the lusts of fornication and those kinds of lusts, the lusts of covetousness, the lust of pornography, the lusts of gain, the lust of mammon, of money. We deny those things at the first, at the beginning. And this is kind of cleaning off the dirty dishes before you have a meal on them. This is sweeping out that room in your person, in you, before you start to bring in the good things. If you want to turn to Luke chapter 11, we can read this little, it's not a parable, or maybe it is a parable. Luke 11, chapter verse 24. When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places, seeking rest and finding none. He saith, I will return unto my house whence I came out. And when he cometh, he findeth it swept and garnished. Then goeth he and taketh him seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first. So we should fill out this well-swept room with good things, with the things of God, with godly things, the Word of God. And this is instructive of what we're reading about denying. We're going to deny, first of all. And second of all, what is the grace of God that bringeth salvation teach us, cause us to learn how we should be living? In verse 12 again, we see that we should be living soberly. We should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Living soberly in this present world is living in a sound mind, with temperance, with stability, discreetly. Living righteously in this present world is, and I found this in the Webster's 1928, and I love this turn of phrase, righteously is agreeably to rectitude. So I agree with righteousness. I agree with things that are right, and I choose them, and I want them. So that is what this verse is telling us, that we should be living soberly, living righteously, and living godly in this present world. And that is piously in the good sense, with reverence and affection for God. This present world is very instructive here, because we see that this is one of the two words in the Bible used for world. The first one is not the one that we're talking about, and that is the one that talks about the order, natural order of the universe, natural order of our world. The word cosmos, and you hear that in the word cosmetic. So a woman would apply cosmetics to bring her beauty into order, and that's kind of the idea of the order of the stars and the moon and the sun and the mountains and the fields and the hills and our weather patterns and all of that. This is not talking about this. This is the other word that is translated as world. This is eon, and that's talking about the age. So this is the spirit of the age, or the time that we live in. So this present world is speaking of our time. In Timothy, 2 Timothy 4:10, for Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed into Thessalonica. So Timothy, Paul is telling Timothy that Demas had rather grabbed onto this present world than continue to follow him, to follow after Jesus. And in Romans 12:2, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Be not conformed to this world. This is the same expression. So in our life, we have this world, the spirit of the age. It's pressing on us. It's constantly trying to impose itself into our lives. And Paul is instructing Titus here that we should be living soberly and living righteously and living godly in this present world. So this is what the grace of God that bringeth salvation teaches us. It teaches us to be denying, and it teaches us how we should be living. And it also teaches us that we should be looking. If you look at verse 13, we should be looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God, of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Excuse me. What does the grace of God that bringeth salvation teach us? That we should be looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the saved, this is an expectation of joy. This should be an expectation of joy. Do the young people here feel that way about that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ? Or is your blessed hope buying that first car or getting married? It's easier for someone that's more in my phase of life and older to look for this blessed hope, because we have experienced a lot more of life. We've experienced a lot more of the world, and we know that it's nothing to be grasped. It's nothing to be, we don't want to remain in it.
Right.
We want to be out of it.
Right.
But we can't be taken out of it. We are here, and we will do our service. We will preach the gospel. We will live our lives. But the grace of God that bringeth salvation teaches us that we should be looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ. So for the saved, this is an expectation of joy, but for the unsaved, it's not so. It's either no expectation at all, or it's something quite different. It's an expectation of judgment. This statement is also one of the most clear statements of the deity of Christ, and you find it a number of times in these so-called pastoral epistles. You find it in Timothy and in Titus. This expression is used a lot about equating Jesus as God and our Savior. So this is a wonderful, wonderful, comforting statement that we see this. Again, I'm not a grammaticist, but there is a rule called the Granville-Sharp rule that when we have this conjunction in there, and, it's not speaking about two different people, it's speaking of one person. So this is the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. It can also be rendered, this statement, the great God and Savior of us, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So I find great comfort and joy in that statement. So why should we be denying ungodliness and denying worldly lust? Why should we be living soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world? Why should we be looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ? Should we be doing these things to earn salvation? Should we be doing these things to earn favor with God? Hopefully everybody in this room knows that that's not the right answer. There are many religions, Catholicism for one, that have rules, have do's and don'ts. They have you obtain a good standing with God not out of grace but out of fulfilling obligation. There are holy days of obligation that you're in big trouble if you miss. If you don't show up at church on one of these holy days of obligation, that's a very bad thing. You might have to spend an extra millennium in purgatory in order to pay that off for missing that. This is a great burden foisted upon innocent people throughout history, that they are trusting in these false leaders, these false teachers that are teaching them that grace is not grace. Grace is work. So God teaches us that this is wrong. So are we denying living and looking so that we may earn our salvation? No, we're denying and living and looking because Jesus gave himself for us. Look at verse 14. who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. That he might redeem us from all iniquity. Redeem is to make a purchase. He purchased us. He freed us by paying the ransom. He did not pay this ransom to the devil. That's another heresy. That's a false theology. He paid the ransom to God to satisfy the holy demands of the law that sinners must die. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So that God may show mercy, but he has the need for a legal means to do so. And that is what Jesus Christ giving himself for us provided. Because we do not deserve to be redeemed, we are by the grace of God, the grace of God that bringeth salvation through faith. If I can join Ephesians 2:8 in with what we're talking about here, the grace of God that bringeth salvation is for ye are saved by grace through faith. And this has appeared to all men, which is spoken again back in verse 11. So the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. God's grace is sufficient to save all, but efficient only in some. I was a little tentative about speaking that phrase. Pastor Brooks and I talked about it, because that phrase is twisted around. It's not from the Bible. The grace of God is sufficient to save all. Jesus' blood is sufficient to save every single one of us, every single person on this planet, everyone that's lived. But it is only efficient in some, and those are the ones that have believed, that are saved by faith. There is a Calvinistic version of that is quite different. Jesus gave himself for us that he might purify unto himself a peculiar people. And peculiar doesn't mean strange, doesn't mean weird, doesn't mean odd. This is from the 1600s. This is a Shakespearean English, the absolute peak of the English language, the height of the English language. And peculiar has a different meaning. It means that it's special unto oneself. The king has a treasure chest, and that treasure chest sits in a special room where the taxes are counted and where the gifts are brought in from far lands, and the accounting of all the treasures of the kingdom are counted and accounted for. Yet there is this special treasure that sits in the corner in a special chest that only the king has that key for, and it's for his peculiar use. It's his own, his special. Special treasure, his precious treasure. That is what this word peculiar means. It is that specialness, that preciousness for his own particular use. And it's as if this king were to open this up and it would be a jewel of great price, a wonderful, precious jewel. And like living stones, like a stone, like a jewel, a gem. And so we are a peculiar people that Jesus has purified unto himself. We are his jewels, we are his gems, we are his precious things. I wonder a lot, thinking to myself, why would God do this? Why would he provide salvation for us? We don't deserve it, I don't deserve it. And this is a wonderful statement right here, that he might purify unto himself a peculiar people zealous of good works, the works that we find earlier in this passage, to live soberly, to live righteously, and to live godly. So as you sweep out your room and deny ungodliness and worldly lusts, are you filling it with the good things? Are you living soberly? Are you living righteously? Are you living godly? For the blood of Jesus is in fact sufficient for all. Have you received it? Is this you? Are you one of these people? For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, to all of us, to all who live, Let's pray. In Jesus' name, Father, hear my prayer. I thank you for your word, Lord. Thank you for the privilege to read it, to attempt, Lord, to be your vessel. Father God, I ask that you would bless this word, this passage, in our hearts and minds. Be with us now as we continue in the service. In Jesus' name, amen.